Hello friends, in the previous video we have discussed about the approach to goiter. Now, there we have seen the quadruple assessment for the goiter. What are the basic components of the quadruple assessment? Now we will see the further management of the goiter in further detail and how do we follow up a patient after thyroidectomy. So whatever we are going to discuss, we are going to discuss with reference to the American Thyroid Association guidelines, and there are a lot of controversies in the management of goiter, but we will stick to the American Thyroid Association guidelines and the standard test books while we discuss this algorithm. So what we have discussed previously, a brief summary. First, the patient comes to us with a goiter, which is any visible or palpable swelling. So when the patient comes to us with a goiter, there are few possibilities that it can be either a diffuse goiter, it can be a solitary thyroid nodule, or it can be a multinodular goiter. So there are three possibilities when you examine the patient after you have taken a detailed history and examined the patient. That is the first component of the quadruple assessment. You find that the goiter can be of one of the three types. Now, when the patient has a diffuse goiter, always rule out any physiological goiter, because you don't have to do a further assessment for a physiological goiter. You just have to wait and watch and follow up the patient, for the goiter usually resolves in follow-up. So in a diffuse goiter, always keep in mind that there is a possibility of physiological goiter. The maximum risk of malignancy is associated with a solitary thyroid nodule. For a solitary thyroid nodule or a multinodular goiter and the rest of the diffuse goiters, we have to keep the patient in the quadruple assessment algorithm. And the next step will be the lab investigation. We will go for the TSH. Now, depending on the TSH, we go for the ultrasound assessment. Now, ultrasound can be cystic or solid. For a solid, we do the thyroid staging. On the basis of the thyroid, we decide whether the patient requires an FNSE or not. Now, we do the FNSE. The FNSE reporting has been done as per the Bethesda, as we have seen all this in the previous video. Now, the FNSE reporting has come as per the Bethesda system. We will look into each of them in detail so that we know the management of goiter subsequently. Now, when the FNSE report comes out to be the first group of Bethesda, that is non-diagnostic. Now, what do we do in this scenario? We have to go for a repeat FNSE. There is no doubt that we go for a repeat FNSE, but this time the American Thyroid Association, they recommend that the repeat FNSE should be done on ultrasound guidance, because you might miss a nodule on FNSE if it is not done on image guidance. The second group of Bethesda system was benign. Now, what do we do if the report of the FNSE comes out to be benign? That is maybe a colloid goiter. What do we do if the report comes out to be benign? See, there are very few indications of going for a surgery. What are the indications of surgery? We have to know that number one is malignancy. If the FNSE report says malignancy, then we go for surgery. Number two, if the FNSE is unable to rule out malignancy, that is, it is either suspicious of malignancy or a neoplasm or an atypia, in that case you go for surgery. Number three, if there is thyrotoxicosis, you first control the thyrotoxicosis with medications and then you take the patient for surgery. Number four, if the patient has pressure symptoms like compression of the vital structures, compression on the trachea, compression on the nerve, compression on the vessels like carotid or jugular vein. So if the patient has pressure symptoms, then we go for surgery. And number five, when do we go for surgery? Number five is cosmetic reason. So we cannot say that for benign we never do surgery. We can do surgery for benign cases, as in if the patient is having a large benign tumor that is causing pressure symptoms, or the patient is having cosmetic issues, or if the patient is having features of thyrotoxicosis. Now, in that case only we go for surgery in benign scenario. Having seen what are the basic indications for surgery in a patient with goiter, let us see one very important thing, what the ATA guidelines have to say when the report comes out to be benign. The first thing that the ATA guidelines says is, if the nodule is benign on cytology, you don't have to do any further diagnostic test or treatment at this stage. Again, treatment is not required if the patient does not have pressure symptoms. If the patient does not have cosmetic issues, then you don't have to go on treatment. Otherwise, no treatment is required for a benign lesion on cytology. Now, let us see further. How do you follow this patient? As per the ATA guidelines, it is recommended that all the benign thyroid nodules, they should be followed with serial ultrasound examination. Not only clinical examinations, but you have to go for ultrasound of the neck and the thyroid every 6 to 18 months. That is ideally around 1 year interval. If you find that on a follow-up ultrasound, the size of the nodule is stable. Now, what is a stable size? That means there should be not more than 50% change in the overall volume of the lesion, or there should be at least less than 20% increase in two nodule dimensions. At least in the two dimensions, there should be less than 20% increase. Then you can say that this is a stable nodule. And in those nodules, you don't have to do yearly follow-up. You can increase the interval to 3 to 5 years. So these are the ATA guideline recommendations. Another very important point, that if there is evidence of growth, that if you find that there is more than 50% increase in the volume, or if you find that there is more than 20% increase in any two of the dimensions, then in that case, what you will do, the FNSC should be repeated, preferably with ultrasound guidance. These are the ATA guidelines, and very important because they can be asked in the exams as well as for clinical practice, they're important. What we do, if it is benign, we don't do surgery. It is not indicated unless the patient has pressure symptoms, unless the patient has thyrotoxicosis, or unless the patient has cosmetic issues. We don't do surgeries. How do we follow up a patient? It's as per the recommendations of American Thyroid Association. Suppose the report comes out to be ATPA of undetermined significance. So the third is ATPA of undetermined significance. In these patients, there is possibility of malignancy, but it is basically an indeterminate lesion. So what we do, we can go for a repeat FNSC, because since there is a chance of malignancy, the management would go to surgery. Let us see what the ATA guideline has to say. As per the ATA guideline, it is recommended that if there is an isolated indeterminate solitary nodule, we prefer a limited surgical procedure. It is said that you go for a thyroid lobectomy if you find a isolated thyroid nodule, and that is ATPA of undetermined significance. You don't have to go for an FNAC. This time you can straightforward go for a thyroid lobectomy. Let us see the next recommendation, what they say. If you find that the tumor is more than 4 cm, or if there is increased risk of malignancy, there are features suggestive of increased risk of malignancy, like the size being more than 4 cm, if there is marked ATPA in biopsy, or there is any suspicious of cancer, in those cases, you will go for a total thyroidectomy. So these are the American Thyroid Association guidelines when you find an AUS in a cytology. Now, there is another recommendation which is very important nowadays, that even molecular markers are being recommended for this indeterminate stages. What are the molecular markers? Very important. The red PTC gene, RAS, BRAF genes. All these genes are thyroid cancer markers. So these are recommended for indeterminate stage, which can help to guide the further management. Now let us move ahead and let us see what we do if the FNSC Bethesda comes out to be number 4, that is follicular neoplasm. Now, if the report comes out to be follicular neoplasm, we have already discussed that the FNAC cannot differentiate between the follicular adenoma and the follicular cancer. So the report will be in the form of follicular neoplasm. Now, what to do? Whether to consider it as benign or the malignant? There are two school of thoughts. One school of thought recommends that you go for a lobectomy, and if the biopsy comes out to be cancer, you go for a thyroidectomy, depending on the size of the primary tumor. Now, what the ATA guidelines have to say, the ATA guidelines have said that if the cytology comes out to be follicular neoplasm, there is a possibility that you can consider for an iodine-123 scan. Now, why would someone go for an iodine-123 scan? Since the FNAC could not differentiate between adenoma and carcinoma, what we can do with an iodine scan, we can differentiate a functioning nodule, a hot nodule versus a cold nodule, and we can determine the possibility of cancer, as cold nodule might have more possibility of cancer. It is not to be done in all the cases. It is said in the recommendation that this may be considered. So this is a very potential question, and this may be considered. So it is a potential option for management as well. So what we can do for a follicular neoplasm, we can go for a lobectomy in a follicular neoplasm. If the HP comes out to be malignancy, and if there is high risk factors and comes out to be malignancy, we can go for completion thyroidectomy, or we can go as per this, we can do a iodine-123 thyroid scan, and depending on that, we can find out whether it's a cold nodule or a hot nodule, and depending on that, we can decide whether it's a benign or a malignant. But again, this is not very specific for cancer. So let's see, what if the FNSC report comes out to be suspicious for malignancy? That is to 5. If the FNAC report comes out to be suspicious for malignancy, what do we do next? So there is a very clear guideline given by the American Thyroid Association, and that recommendation is that if the reading is suspicious for papillary carcinoma, then you don't require any scanning. straightforward, you decide you will go for either lobectomy or a total thyroidectomy, and this will be depending on the size of the lesion and the risk factors associated. We will see this while we discuss the cancer. If the report comes out to be suspicious for cancer, you either go for a lobectomy or a thyroidectomy depending on the size of the cancer and the risk factors. We will discuss about the risk factors and what is the size cutoff. The size cutoff is usually 1 centimeter. If the size cutoff is less than 1 centimeter, we can go for lobectomy. If it is more than 1 centimeter, we go for total thyroidectomy. And if there is associated risk factors, then also we go for total thyroidectomy. So this is what we do if the report comes out to be suspicious for malignancy. What do we do if the report comes out to be malignancy? Now, what are the different thyroid cancers? We already know the thyroid cancers are basically two types. The thyroid cancers are either a differentiated thyroid cancer or undifferentiated thyroid cancer. Differentiated thyroid cancer can be those arising from the follicular cells and those arising from the parafollicular cell. That is parafollicular C cells. The cancer that arises from the follicular cells, they can be either papillary thyroid cancer or they can be follicular thyroid cancer. And the cancer that arises from the parafollicular C cells are the medullary thyroid cancer. Undifferentiated thyroid cancer is known as the anaplastic thyroid cancer. Now, as we have discussed that the FNAC cannot differentiate a follicular neoplasm, that is a follicular thyroid cancer, from a follicular adenoma. Therefore, on the basis of FNAC, we can either identify a papillary thyroid cancer or a medullary thyroid cancer or anaplastic thyroid cancer. The management of anaplastic thyroid cancer we're going to study later. For the time being, let us focus on what do we do if we find that the FNAC report is suggestive of papillary thyroid cancer. So if the report of the FNAC comes out to be papillary thyroid cancer, then the recommendation is that if the size is more than 1 centimeter, we go for a near total or a total thyroidectomy as per the American Thyroid Association guidelines. If the size is less than 1 centimeter and the patient is having low risk unifocal tumor, then in that case we can go for just thyroid lobectomy. So this is very important guideline given by the American Thyroid Association, which recommends 1 centimeter as the cutoff size. If the size is more than 1 centimeter, then we go for near total or total thyroidectomy. But if the size is less than 1 centimeter with low risk features, we can consider for just lobectomy even in papillary thyroid cancer. Now we know one important point about papillary thyroid cancer, that this spreads the lymphatics, and the most common site of metastasis are the cervical lymph nodes. How do we deal with the cervical lymph nodes? It's again very important concept. What do we do with the lymph nodes? We have to address both the central group of lymph nodes and the peripheral group of lymph nodes. We have to understand what do we do with the central lymph nodes, that is level 6, and what do we do with the lateral lymph nodes. So let us look into the first, what we do with the central group of lymph nodes. Regarding this central group of lymph nodes, the American Thyroid Association, they recommend that we have to go for a therapeutic central node dissection in all the patients who have this either clinically involved or we see that the central nodes have been involved on imaging. In all those patients, we go for therapeutic central node dissection. But what is the role of prophylactic node dissection? They have said that if prophylactic central node dissection may be performed in patients whose size of the tumor is more than 4 centimeter. That is, if the primary tumor is larger than 4 centimeter, that is T3 onwards, we go for a prophylactic central node dissection, if the lateral or bilateral. That is the recommendation. Now, it is said that if the primary tumor is small in size and it is just restricted to the thyroid gland with no involvement of the central lymph nodes, then we can just go for a total thyroidectomy or near total thyroidectomy without need of prophylactic central node dissection. So this is a very important guidelines regarding central node dissection. Therapeutic dissection always have to be done if the nodes are involved. Prophylactic dissections only if the size of the tumor is large, that is T3 or T4, and it's not to be done if the size is small, that is T1 or T2. Though there may be different school of thoughts, but these are the American Thyroid Association guidelines. Now, what do we do with the lateral lymph nodes? How do we address the lateral lymph nodes? It is said that lateral neck dissection is considered only in therapeutic purposes, only if the patients are palpable or imaging diagnosed lymph nodes, and that has been proven to be cancer on FNAC. In that case only, you will go for a therapeutic lateral neck dissection. This is the American Thyroid Association guideline. So that's about the management of the papillary thyroid cancer. We know that how to deal with the primary tumor, when to do lobectomy, when to do for total thyroidectomy. We know how to deal with the central node dissection, and we know when to do prophylactic neck dissection and when not to do prophylactic dissection and when to do lateral neck dissection. All this has to be very clear. Again, we come back to the follicular neoplasm.
Now, follicular neoplasm, we already know that for a follicular neoplasm, if it turns out to be follicular neoplasm, the guideline was we can either go for a lobectomy straightforward or we can either go for an iodine scan, though lobectomy is more justified. Now, what the guideline says, suppose you have done a lobectomy for a follicular neoplasm and the report comes out to be invasive carcinoma or follicular carcinoma, you can see capsular invasion or angioinvasion. In that case, you have to go for a completion of the total thyroidectomy, but there is no role of any prophylactic node dissection is not needed. This is the guideline given by the American Thyroid Association. This is very important that prophylactic neck dissection is not required in follicular thyroid cancer because this usually spread by hematogenous route. Follicular neoplasm, we go for a lobectomy. If it is less than 4 cm, if it is more than 4 cm, we go for near total or total thyroidectomy. Regarding the lymph node dissection, the guidelines say there is no indication for any prophylactic lymph node dissection. But again, there are different school of thoughts. It also says that prophylactic central neck dissection may be considered with large tumors. If the size of the tumor is very large, you can think about central neck dissection. But that varies from center to center. Now, what do we do if the FNAC comes out to be medullary thyroid cancer? If we see parafollicular cells in the FNAC and we suspect a medullary thyroid cancer, in that case, the management is slightly different from the other thyroid cancers because medullary thyroid cancers might be having 20% of the familial cases. And they have this genetic association with the RET gene mutation. And also they are associated with Menn syndrome, multiple endocrine neoplasia. So what do we do when we suspect a medullary thyroid cancer? The first thing that we do is, first of all, we do the genetic study and we try to find out whether the patient is a RET mutation carrier. Once we have done that, the next thing is we rule out pheochromocytoma because Menn syndrome, there might be associated pheochromocytoma. So we must rule out a pheochromocytoma. It is recommended that the urine catecholamines is the gold standard for this. We don't rely on imaging. The urine catecholamines has to be done. The 24-hour urine VMA is the most reliable for this. If we find pheochromocytoma, it has to be treated first. If we don't find pheochromocytoma, then we go for management of medullary thyroid cancer. For a medullary thyroid cancer, the guidelines are very clear. We go for a total thyroidectomy always. For a medullary thyroid cancer, what are the recommendations? Let's see. We go for a total thyroidectomy. This is one cancer that responds only to surgery. There are no other modalities that this tumor responds to. So we have to go for total thyroidectomy because we cannot rely on iodine ablation later on. And also we have to go for a bilateral prophylactic neck dissection in these patients. As I said, this patient responds only to surgery. We cannot leave behind any tumor and think about giving a radioiodine ablation later on because this won't respond to radioactive iodine. So we have to go for aggressive surgery on the first attempt itself. We go for bilateral prophylactic central node dissection. It should be routinely performed. These are the guidelines. Now, what else? What the guidelines says that regarding the neck dissection, this is advised when the patient is having palpable or image detected cervical lymph nodes or if the calcitonin levels, which is a tumor marker for this, is raised, that is more than 400. In that case, you go for an ipsilateral or bilateral neck dissection. This is important guideline. Some groups also said that lateral neck dissection to be done if the central lymph nodes are involved or if the primary tumor is more than 1.5 centimeter, but you need a frozen section to say that a central lymph node is involved or preoperative FNAC if it is diagnostic of metastasis in the central lymph nodes, then it is recommended to go for lateral neck dissection. The take-home message is we always do a prophylactic central neck dissection bilaterally plus minus lateral neck dissection. And we know the criteria when to do lateral neck dissections. So this is what we do for medullary thyroid cancer. Now, having understood this basic treatment options for the different types of thyroid cancer, have you understood how do we approach a thyroid cancer and how do we read the FNAC reports and how do we interpret the FNAC reports and how do we treat the patient depending on each report? Let us find out what do we do after we have done the thyroidectomy. Now, once we have done the thyroidectomy, whether total or partial, the follow-up of this patient starts from the immediate post-op period. Now, what do we do immediately after operation? We should be very careful to look for recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. So first thing is we should be able to identify recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. Even this can be identified during extubation of the patient after anesthesia. During extubation of the patient, this can be identified recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. The second thing is we should be very careful in identifying any immediate post-op bleeding. immediate hemorrhage. We should be careful to identify primary hemorrhage because the patient might develop immediate respiratory distress after surgery, and that stitches have to be removed immediately to drain the hemorrhage. And number three, one should be able to identify hypocalcemia due to parathyroid removal, which is more common in 2 to 5 days after surgery. So once you have been very carefully able to identify any immediate post-op complications, what do we do next? Once we have identified that the patient does not have any of these post-op complications, we plan to discharge the patient. Now, during discharge, we prescribe levothyroxine tablets. Especially when the patient has undergone total thyroidectomy, we prescribe these levothyroxine tablets at a dose of 1.6 microgram per kg, which comes out to be 112 microgram for a 70 kg individual. And then we discharge the patient. We ask the patient to follow up with the histopathology report. Now the patient has come to the clinic after 7 days or 10 days with the histopathology report. Let us see what do we do next. Depending on the HPE report, the patient can either have cancer or it might be a benign report. If it comes out to be benign, the patient will continue his levothyroxine medication and will follow up in the clinic with TSH report. But if the report comes out to be cancer, then the patient has to be divided into different risk, and we will see how do the risk stratification is done. There are various methods of risk stratification in thyroid cancer. Some risk stratification methods are EMIS scoring, AGES scoring, MACIS scoring, and there is another by AJCC. So what we are going to see, the AJCC method of risk stratification. Now this is the AJCC method of risk stratification. Now after the histopathology report has come, now we decide whether the patient is in low risk group or whether the patient is intermediate or high risk group. Now if we understand the low and high risk group, we will be able to understand the intermediate risk group. The low risk group are those patients who do not have any evidence of metastasis, whether local or distal. And there has been R0 resection. The histopathology report says there has been R0 resection. There has been no invasion of the local structures. And the tumor does not contain any aggressive histology like tall cell, insular, columnar, or any vascular invasion. So all this goes in favor of low-risk tumors. Who are the high-risk patients? The high-risk patients are those who have macroscopic tumor invasion, incomplete tumor resection, distant metastasis, and high level of thyroglobulin on post-treatment scan. We are going to look about the thyroglobulin a little while later on. So the patient has come to us with the histopathology report. We can identify whether the patient is low-risk or high-risk or intermediate risk. Once we have identified the patient into a low-risk, intermediate risk, or high-risk, what do we do next? Suppose the patient underwent lobectomy and now it comes out to be under high risk. Now we have to decide what to do further. What the American Thyroid Association guidelines have to say, what we have to do, we have to think about the completion thyroidectomy. Now this should be offered to patients who should have been offered total or near total thyroidectomy, but they have underwent lobectomy. Now this patient has to be undertaken for completion thyroidectomy. If the patient does not want, or if the patient wants an alternative, then the alternative is radioiodine ablation of the remaining lobe of the thyroid gland. So this is very important. What do we do with the residual thyroid gland which is left behind in high-risk patients? Completion thyroidectomy has to be done in all the patients with thyroid cancer except those with small tumor, unifocal tumor, interthyroidal node negative, low-risk tumors. So it has to be offered to the high-risk or intermediate-risk tumors. What do we do next? The patient has come to us with the histopathology report. We have done the risk assessment and we have planned what to do. Suppose we have done a total thyroidectomy. What we have to do now is the patient was on levothyroxine. So we will stop the levothyroxine. And what we will do, we will stop it at least for 4 weeks. And what we can do to prevent the patient from becoming hypothyroid, we can start the patient on T3. This has a shorter half-life. So we can stop this 2 weeks before we decide the patient for a radioactive ablation. So what we are basically planning to do, we are planning to do a radioactive iodine scan. This will be a screening test, which will be done when the TSH rises at least more than 30. So we have stopped the levothyroxine. We wait for the TSH to rise. And when the TSH becomes more than 30, now the patient can be taken up for a screening radioactive iodine scan. So how do we do a screening and iodine scan? We send the patient to the Department of Nuclear Medicine. There, the patient is given pills, tablets of iodine 131 or iodine 123. And we give at a dose of 1 to 3 millicurie. And this is a very screening dose. So we ask the patient to go to the Nuclear Medicine Department. The patient goes there. They are given a tablet of iodine 123. And the patient takes the tablet. It's very small dose, 1 to 3 millicurie, and this will emit gamma radiations. The patient is asked to come after again 24 hours and then detect this uptake with a gamma counter machine known as Giger counter. So with the Giger counter, they'll pick up the radioactive iodine uptake. If the uptake after 24 hours is less than 1%, then this is considered to be a normal. But if the uptake comes out to be more than 1%, then there is chance of metastasis or residual tumor. In these patients whose uptake comes out to be normal, we can start the again levothyroxine and send the patient home and do regular follow-up. And in the patient who comes out to be metastasis or residual tumor, in these patients, we give therapeutic dose of iodine ablation, radioactive iodine. And how do we do give therapeutic dose is around 30 to 100 millicurie for low-risk patients. And for high or intermediate-risk patients, it's about 100 to 200 millicurie. So in these patients, we give therapeutic dose of ablation. That's how we do the radioactive iodine ablation, at least after 4 to 6 weeks of primary thyroidectomy. Now let us see what the ADA guidelines have to say with respect to the radioactive iodine ablation. The first thing that it says is the radioactive iodine ablation, see, it's recommended for all the patients who has known distant metastasis or gross extrathyroidal extension or the tumor size more than 4 cm. These are the three indications when you can directly go for a radioactive iodine ablation irrespective of a screening test. These are those patients where you don't have to do a screening test. You can directly go for a therapeutic radioactive iodine ablation. The second thing that they say, the radioactive iodine ablation is not recommended for patients with unifocal tumor less than 1 cm if there is no risk factors. And even for multifocal tumor with less than 1 cm, it is not recommended unless all the foci are less than 1 cm. These are very important guidelines where we don't give and where we give radioactive iodine ablation. So what do we do for tumor more than 1 cm? If the tumor is more than 1 cm, 1 to 4 cm, and the tumor has documented lymph node metastasis or high-risk features, we know about the high-risk features, we have discussed it previously. So if any of the high-risk features is present in a tumor 1 to 4 cm, again, we go for a direct therapeutic radioactive ablation. We don't have to do a screening test. So these are the basic guidelines. Let us see one more thing. What this ATA guidelines say, the minimum dose that is required for a radioactive ablation is 30 to 100 microcurie. And it is also said that if a more aggressive tumor histology is present or in case of high-risk features or intermediate risk, we give 100 to 200. We have already seen this. These are there in the recommendations by ATA. Now we have done the radioactive ablation. How do we follow up the patient? We follow up the patient by 6-monthly thyroglobulin. And if in the follow-up, the thyroglobulin level comes out to be more than 2 nanogram per ml, this is highly suggestive of recurrence or metastasis. So very specific marker of recurrence or metastasis if the thyroglobulin comes out to be more than 2. We also do follow-up imaging. On follow-up, we do clinical examination and imaging, ultrasound imaging. On the follow-up, we make sure that the TSH is available. Now, regarding the follow-up TSH, there are 3 criteria. After the therapeutic ablation has been done, the patient is again started on the levothyroxine. Now, the levothyroxine that is given is not supplemental, but it is given at a suppressive dose. Levothyroxine is given at such a dose so that the TSH is kept at suppressed levels. And the target TSH is for a low risk, the TSA should be less than 0.5. If the patient is intermediate risk group, then the TSA should be between 0.1 to 0.5. And if the patient is a high risk, then the TSA should be less than 0.1. So these are the things to be kept in mind during follow-up of a thyroid cancer. It starts with the evaluation of the histopathology report and the risk stratification of the patient, followed by doing the screening test for the radioactive iodine uptake. And then if the report comes out to be positive, we go for therapeutic radioactive iodine ablation. And then we restart the thyroxine at a suppressive dose to keep the TSH below the target levels. And we do regular follow-up with clinical examination, ultrasound, and thyroglobulin. Thyroglobulin is usually done at 6 months. The clinical examination ultrasound, it's 6 months to 1 year. It varies from center to center. Most of the thing that I discussed is with the reference to the ATA guidelines, because this thyroid is a very controversial topic. Different textbooks have different recommendations. So if we stick to the guidelines, we can answer most of the questions. That's about the approach to the thyroid. Stay tuned for more upcoming videos. You can drop your feedback in the comment section. Thank you for watching this video.